Boys will be boys. I don't know if you can see the little horsey in the background there. He come over here and dropped. Buddy's dropping. They're kind of sniffing. The little one's trying to say, hey, you ain't so big. Just because I'm a little horsey, I'm still a guy. Now, I don't know if there's any mares in heat out here. And sometimes horses drop for no reason. Sometimes they drop because they got to pee. Sometimes they drop because they smell a mare in heat. Sometimes they drop because something feels good and, you know, they just rub them the right way or scratch them right way and they'll drop. If you put warm water when you want to clean the sheath, I've heard that'll help them drop. I don't know. I don't think I've ever tried it, but maybe I have. I forgot. But watching these two guys here kind of fronting each other off. This little horse doesn't get to get out in a herd, and it's a little pony. I don't know if it's a miniature horse or what it is. It's a small horse to me. So it's kind of hanging out here, and when Buddy came over and dropped, I thought it was kind of cute that he came and stood next to the fence and also dropped. Now, why they did it or what was going on, I'm not sure. But I thought it was kind of cute, and I wanted to discuss a couple other things about a lot of my tapes out here. I'll come over here and show you what I've done with this water bucket. Because you got horses. When I talk about setting horses up to fail, we do things that create bad habits. What somebody did out here is there was a couple horses that like to play in the water and splash. So they've put the water bucket on the ground. They've put a low, small water bucket on the ground. The horses come in and stick their hooves in it all the time. And when a horse put their hooves in the water, it may look cute and they splash and they're cooling off. And, oh, look how cute he's playing in the water. Well, there's all kind of bacteria and thrush, and they walk through cat poop or animal poop or their own poop. You don't want a horse's hoof in the water that he's drinking, okay? That's just, it's not a good thing. It's not sanitary. So what I've done is I slowly raise this higher and higher, if you can see there, to make this so they can't get their feet up over it. Now, later, after they learn to stop this, I can lower this. But right now, I have to get this high enough to where when they try to get their feet over to get their feet into the water bucket, it stops them. So I've prevented the wrong answer. Leaving the water bucket on the ground and coming out here and throwing rocks at them or chasing them off when they do it isn't going to work because I can't be out here 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. So I have to figure out a way to keep these horses' hooves out of this water bucket. And by raising it, they're going to try and they're going to learn that I can't get my foot in. So after several tries or months of trying, they're going to stop trying. Then I can come back and I can take a 2x4 and lower it 2 inches, lower it 2 more inches, if I need to. I mean, the only problem with having this high is it's kind of a pain to empty and clean, and it's a little bit more work. But I'm a stickler on horses having clean water. I think it's so important to prevent colic. It's so important to keep their immune system good. It's healthy for them, and I think it helps them prevent disease for their immune system. It keeps keep them from colic or getting impaction colic because they'll drink more. When they do drink, they're not getting bacteria. It's not, you know, tearing down their immune system. Also, the more water they drink, the more it keeps their system moving, which will prevent sand colic because it removes sand. So there's all kind of benefits to clean water. And I know I talk about this a lot, and people say that I'm kind of anal about my water for my horses, and maybe I am. But, you know, like I said, if I don't think I should be drinking out of it, then, you know, I'm not going to let my horses drink out of it. So what I've done is I've raised this, and this is called preventing the wrong answer. Everybody wants to always push, and try for that right answer. I got to make my horse do the right answer. Well, there's another way with horse training to where you can prevent the wrong answer. And the only thing the horse is allowed to do is the right answer. And you know, when people say these little sayings, oh, I'll make the right thing easy and the wrong thing hard. Well, what they're talking about is you've got to make the wrong thing hard or difficult or impossible. If I don't want my horse getting away and pulling, I have to take away his ability to get away and pull. I have to tie him with a solid rope and a good tie point so he doesn't get away. Because every time he gets away, he learns the wrong answer. He learns that pulling gets him freedom. I don't want him learning that. So you got these people out here teach people, oh, don't make sure and tie a slip knot. You don't want your horse trapped. And tie him with a hay string so if he pulls, he can get away and it won't scare him and he won't panic. And you got all these crazy ideas about how to tie a horse, and you teach a horse to pull. You know, and then you got these clinicians out here selling all their fancy, I don't know who sells it. It might be Clint. I don't want to give Clint a bad name, but I think he's got one of these fancy slip knot thingies that when the horse pulls, it slides and he learns. Look, all that crap just teaches bad habits, and it gets people money. So when you're thinking of horse training, don't always think, I got to make the horse get the right answer. Part of horse training is preventing the wrong answer, stopping the ability of the horse to do the wrong thing. If my horse wants to buck, a horse can't buck real good when he's running. So a lot of people want a horse bucks, you know, because they've been told, oh, do your one rein stop, grab that head and put him in a spin, and you circle him, and you don't let that... Okay, a horse can learn, he may learn from that, and it may work. But a lot of horses are going to learn that when I buck, I don't have to run. Because every time I buck, this stupid rider just grabs one rein and makes me do a circle. And I'd rather circle than run. So every time you try, so I get these emails, my horse, you know, Rick, when I try to canter, he bucks, and I don't know why. He does so good on ground, he does so good walking, but when I canter, he bucks. Well, that's probably because you've been doing the stinking one rein, you know, fix all that everybody wants to tell everybody, fixes all your problems, do your run rein, take the head away, and make him circle. That's true, but you can't get caught up in that. I just did a video on why women are set up to fail. And I don't know if I covered that clear enough to where it's like, look, you cannot get caught up and this is the only thing I can do. Because as soon as you do it and it doesn't work, if you keep doing it, it ain't going to change. The horse isn't going to change. Hi, bud. Hi, Biddy. So you got to be flexible, and that's part of being a long-term horseman or horse person. You get more tools in your box and you figure out quicker. When something doesn't work, well, I'll do this. And if this don't work, well, I'll do this. And I'll try this. And, you know, people are going to write me, well, how do you know when to change? And how do you... You just learn over time. You learn from your mistakes. Okay, a lot of my videos, because I'm holding this phone, I can't do a lot of demonstration and show you, because a lot of things requires two hands. And a guy wrote an excellent comment. God, I can't think of his name. But the other day, if you watch Why Women Are Set Up to Fail or something, I forgot what I called the tape I did the other day. Tanner stopped. He was walking in front of me, and all of a sudden he stopped. And he let me get in front of him and walk beside. And because I was talking and concentrating on what I was saying, I said in a video, I'm not real sure why he stopped right there. Maybe he saw something. I don't know what happened. Somebody who understands horses and who was paying attention totally hit it on the nose. I changed my voice when I was describing something. And whatever I was talking about, because my voice changed and I got passionate like I do and I changed my fluctuation and he heard that change in my voice, he just heard that tone and went, uh-oh, I know I'm not supposed to walk in front of him. Maybe he's telling me I better slow down and walk beside me. And whoever wrote that note, good for you. I'm glad to see that somebody out there... Because a lot of people that watch my videos are kind of amateurs. I mean, somebody that understands horses and is successful with their horses ain't going to watch my videos. Because, I mean, I don't sit around and watch other people's videos. I mean, if I see something stupid and somebody asks me to evaluate a video, I'll watch it. But I don't go around and watch videos and try to comment or tell people what they're doing wrong and all that. I just want you to be successful with your horse because I think it's better for the horse. And if I can give a horse a better life by helping people understand them, that's what I'm trying to do. So if what I say doesn't fit you, you know, every once in a while I'll get a nasty, that's stupid, I do this, and that, you weren't talking to me. Just because I say woman, it doesn't mean every woman. And it can apply to men. And, you know, back to that water bucket over there, when I was filling that water, there was a guy out here who's owned horses his whole life. He's, you know, Mr. You got to show a horse who's boss, and if that horse wants to run, you just turn his head into a pole, and when he runs by, he'll smash his face, and that'll stop him from running. Okay, that's his mentality. So when I tell him I'm moving this up because I want to stop the horse from throwing, oh, shit, those horses got filters. Rick, those horses can drink that water. You ought to see some of the nasty water I've seen horses drink, and they do just fine. Well, that may be true. They may have a filter. And we have filters. But it's not healthy and it's not good. And when you get a horse's hoof in a water bucket and you get all that bacteria and then you get three or four horses doing it and then they're splashing and they're washing dirt and you got hooves and then it sits there and then nobody changes it for a week and it sits out there for a week and then you got birds landing in it and their fleas are dropping in it and they're pooping in it and then you got a squirrel or a raccoon come by or a possum and they want a drink and they climb up in a water bucket and they fall in so all their parasites get in the water and they swim off and you want to sit here because you want to be lazy or tough cowboy and go, oh, that horse has a filter, that ain't gonna hurt him. Idiot comments like that just irritate the shit out of me. And look, a horse has a filter, but they need clean water. And when people start making these stupid comments about, oh, you don't need to do that, and a horse, you don't need to pick those horses' feet. In the wild, they get rocks in their feet. Why do you got to pick their feet? Because you're sitting on them. They aren't carrying your extra weight in the wild. And they aren't moving naturally. And in the wild, when they get a stone bruise, they can't hunt for food and eat. And they end up dying. Okay, so, yeah, can a horse walk with a rock in his foot? Sure he can. But, you know, you get these attitudes, here I go with women again. You know, Rick's always picking on women. There's women out there that want to be that tough cowboy image. They want to say, you know what, I'm not going to be this weak woman. I'm not going to be like these other women, scared and weak and wimpy. I'm going to show this horse who's boss. My grandpa used to break horses, and he put chains on their nose, and they listened, and I'm going to put a chain on their nose, and I'm not going to be one of these wimpy women. And they try to overcompensate, and they move from being a kind person that just understands a horse to this macho, wannabe cowboy, tough cowgirl, I'm going to show him who's boss and cowgirl up. And it's just not good. And it would be the same thing if a guy, I mean, I don't see this as much, but if a guy wanted to be, you know, Mr. Sensitive, and he just went so much lovey-dovey that he couldn't correct a horse, and all he wanted to do was paint his hooves with a nice red color and put little booties on and have it, you know, braid his little hair and put little pretty beads on his mane and, you know, whatever. If a guy did that to a horse, you know, people would call him wimpy and etc., but if a girl gets tough, somehow in the horse world, that's kind of, oh man, that's a real cowgirl. Man, look at her, she's tough on that. Man, she knows how to handle that horse. She shows that horse who's boss. That's BS. I don't care who you are, guy or girl. You impress me or you impress horse other people if they really know what they're looking for by understanding a horse, by getting results without having to result or resort to that aggressive, overbearing, respect my space, show them who's boss, etc. So I jumped to different topics. And again, my videos are more lecture. A lot of people don't have the ability to talk to somebody who has a different philosophy on horses or who wants horsemanship to grow and who sees the world through the horse's eyes. So when I do my videos out here, it's more of a lecture. And for the people that who have attended lectures in college, you got the professor up there yakking, and you tune him out 90% of the time. But the fact that you're sitting there and you do your homework and you learn, he may say 50 things that he thinks are important. And you may only pick up one or two things that you think are important because it either helps you on a test or because it you happen to need it or whatever. But when you listen to somebody lecturing, if you pick up one or two things from my video, then take that and kind of enjoy the fact that you learned at least one thing. You invested maybe 15 minutes to watch one of my videos, and something that I said just resonated, and it got through to you, and it went, oh, okay, I get it. You know what? He said that in every video, and just now, I just get what he meant. I've heard this 20 times, and I never understood what the hell he was talking about, and now I get it. So when I'm doing these lectures, and I'm kind of talking and trying to discuss these things for people, just understand that I don't know who my audience is, but my main audience is normally people that don't understand or is at a pretty low level in their horsemanship, and they're trying to learn. So I don't talk, you know, at a higher level or at an advanced level to where I'm going to start trying to use a whole bunch of terms, or I'm going to start trying to tell you things about feel or timing and try to explain that and just confuse you, because it just doesn't work. It takes time, and it's frustrating, and you're going to fail. But you keep trying, you keep learning, you keep experience, you spend time with your horse. I say this over and over. The horse is the best teacher of the horse. Spend time with your horse. Your horse will teach you. Forget what everybody's telling you. Forget sitting behind that computer. I got people out here always worrying about their horse, can't ride it, and yet they got time to smoke cigarettes, sit down and BS, and water flowers, and look how pretty their horse is, but they can't get out there and work the horse. I'm at 15 minutes, got to go. Hope that helps. Good boy, buddy.